up, meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another all the more as you see the day approaching. So this morning as we gather today, be encouraged. This is what God intends for his people, to be together, to worship together, to pray together. So there is no better place for us to be this morning than in his presence. So let's pray. Lord, thank you for your grace. Thank you for your never-ending mercy. Lord, what a joy it is to gather together as your people, to sing your praises, to listen to your word. Lord, there's no better place for us to be this morning. Amen. And let's sing together.
Thank you.
mercy reign and never die. There's a place, streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed away, I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus. Verse 2. There's a place, there's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in. Sing that again. At the cross, at the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you, where your love ran red and my sin washed white. I owe all to you, I owe. And hear my hope, Jesus, we cry, holy, holy. the chorus, we cry.
And we cry, holy, holy, holy.
We cry.
We cry, holy, holy, holy.
You cry, holy, holy, holy. Is the name.
We cry, holy. Sing worthy.
We cry worthy, worthy, worthy. We cry worthy, worthy, worthy. We cry worthy, worthy, worthy. Is the Lamb.
Worthy is He. Receive honor, glory, power. Lord, worthy are you. Lord, we come through the shed blood of Jesus, and we come freely because of your sacrifice. And we sing, worthy are you, holy are you, Lord, you alone are God. It is good for us to be your presence as your people. So Lord, receive our prayers, receive our praise and our thanks this morning. Amen. Amen. Well, good morning, everyone. Please have a seat.
Can someone turn on the lights, please? Good morning, everyone. My name is Pastor Chair. I'm the Ian Pastor here at the Cleveland KCPC Church. I hope and pray that wherever you are, you're safe and growing your love for God and each other during these difficult and historic times. Just a few announcements, some sad news. Justin Lee, he was going to do the fundraiser today with the meals for the retreat, but his grandfather suddenly died on, Tuesday of a heart attack. So you can pray for Justin Lee's family. And so it was a sudden, I think he was 83 years old. So if you can pray for Justin Lee's family. As talking about the retreat, you know, if you can sign up, our retreat's going to be coming up for college and young adults in Beulah Beach. And so if you can sign up for that, we have a lot of young adults. Young adult college leaders, you can ask them. And also continue to pray for the college kids. They're coming. Okay, they're coming in about 2 weeks, about 50 of them. And so they're going to be coming from all corners of the earth. So they're going to be coming here soon. So please pray. And please pray for the freshman class. We have no idea where they're coming from, who they are, but that they have a home, a spiritual home, either at our church or any church where they can really grow in their relationship with God. But next week, we will have the sandwiches and the meal. Okay, I think it's $10. I think last week I said $8, but I don't know if you heard of inflation. There's been a lot of inflation. It's just Justin, when he does something, he goes all out when it comes to food. So we're actually not going to make that much money. He's going all out, sandwich deluxe kind of thing. And so it helps a great cause. We have no change. So if you have 20, I'm just kidding. But it's $10 next week, okay? Also, as you guys know, Mike and Claire are getting married next week. Immediately, not immediately, 5:30. I guess I need to be there too because I'm officiating. But they're getting married. And so we have a lot of weddings. We have a lot of weddings at this church. It's just fun to see and how you guys met, and it's just fun. So they're getting married next week. So please pray for peace. Please pray for sanity, okay? And so please pray for Mike and Claire. Doing premarital with them has been a total joy as well. Now at this time, if we can have a time of offering, if we can have a time of offering at this time. Thank you. Father, we thank you for your great blessings, your bountiful warehouses of grace upon us. We are so thankful. As we get older, I think a lot of times we realize the blessings that we indeed have received from you. But the greatest of these is the Son, your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you so much that we can just give a tiny fraction of what you've done for us back to you and your kingdom. It is often being used to help those who are oppressed, those who are marginalized in our culture. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If we all join together in confessing our faith, Apostles' Creed, if we join together in confessing our faith as we stand up. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, who was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Knowing that we've all sinned and fall short of God's glory, let us confess our sins to God together in silence at this time. Friends, believe in the good news of Jesus Christ. In him we're forgiven. Amen. Sit down this time. Let's pray. Oh, Father, we are so, so thankful, Father, for giving us life, the life of the ages, life eternal. We thank you so much for the incredible times that you've shown us grace and forgiveness when we deserve judgment. It's just amazing how you will love us, even though you know us completely. It's just undeserved love. We thank you. We pray for this church. May we be a more open church, a more loving church, a less judgmental place, a place of grace, a place of acceptance, a place of where the kingdom of God is here, so that people will know how great you are. We pray for this passage today. May we speak to the most hardened of hearts. You promise in Psalm 51, a broken and contrite heart you will never reject, you will never despise. We thank you so much for that promise. And we thank you for this prayer that you taught us 2,000 years ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. If you can turn to Matthew chapter 7, verse 1 through 7. Matthew chapter 7, verse 1 through, I'm sorry, 7, 1 through 6. Matthew chapter 7, verse 1 through 6. Do not judge, or you too will be judged. But in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, will be measured to you. Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there's a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Do not give dogs what is sacred. Do not throw your pearls to pigs. If you do, they may trample them under their feet and turn and tear you to pieces. This is the word of God. You know, this is one of those messages that I cannot guarantee about the quality of the message, okay? But I promise you, when you leave today, you're going to know exactly what this message is about. It's basically do not judge, okay? You know, I don't read the King James Version very much, the Old English, but when it ever comes to judgment or rebuking, King James Version is the best, okay? Thou shalt not judge. That's their King James Version. Now, some of you guys are like, Pastor Che, this passage has absolutely no relevance in my life because I don't have a problem being judgmental, right? Some of you guys are like, but the person right next to me, he or she surely does, okay? It's funny how sneaky judgmentalism is, right? You can actually start feeling judgment, start feeling judgmental towards people when you're saying, thou shalt not judge, like myself. It's kind of like, it's fun to point your finger at someone and judging them. But we all know, right? When you point your finger at someone, when you're judging them, there's three coming back at you, right? Unless you're Frodo of Lord of the Rings, in which Gollum chewed out one of your fingers. But besides, most people have five fingers, and you have three pointing back at you when you judge. So the good question is, how many exceptions does Jesus allow for not judging others, right? Right? So some of you guys are like, Pastor Chad, I have people in my life who drive me crazy at my work, okay? Is they have a bad personality, or they have some weird religious beliefs, or their politics, oh my gosh, okay? Or they're just so unlikable. And of course, you would think that Jesus would be on your side, and you would say, and of course, he'll say, you can condemn them, right? Of course, they merit condemnation, right? No, he gives absolutely no exception to this about not judging anyone. There are no loopholes, you lawyers. He doesn't ever say, don't judge someone else unless they really have it coming. Then of course you can do it. It never says that. There's a zero tolerance policy of a judgmental spirit in scriptures, okay? In fact, it's interesting, when you read the stories of Jesus, he actually got in trouble for his refusal to be judgmental to the very people that the religious authorities were judging, right? Remember, they judged him. They criticized him for welcoming sinners, and he says he welcomes them and eats with them. And so where people expected to get judgment from Jesus, what did Jesus bring? He always brought love, acceptance, and welcome. Okay? And so if you read scriptures, he's the most non-judgmental being that ever walked on earth. He accepts ethnic rejects, religious heretics, the pagans, the Samaritans, the sexually scandalous, to the corrupt, traitorous tax collectors, to the unclean and untouched lepers. The only people that Jesus condemned, interesting, were the religious leaders who condemned others. Don't you find that interesting? He was incredibly non-judgmental to everyone else, except for one kind of people who judge other people, all right? And the reason is this goes out of his purpose of why he came to earth. We're told in John, for God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. And we know that Jesus is absolutely against condemnation. In Romans chapter 8, it says, therefore, there's now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. How much condemnation? Not a little, not even a trace. There's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. But unfortunately, this is not, we don't really practice this in our world. I find it so ironic that our culture that we live in absolutely hates being judged, right? Don't tell me what to do. Don't judge me. I can do whatever I want to do. Have you noticed that? But have you also noticed our culture is probably the most judgmental culture that ever lived on earth? Have you noticed this? Okay? We have become hypercritical. We become more judgmental than ever. Okay? It's no longer, hey, we can disagree on certain things, on certain topics, but we can still be friends. But now, if you disagree on certain topics, they are more pond scum to you. Okay? Have you noticed that? We can no longer be friends with people we disagree with. We can no longer, we can't do that. And so this world is all about not judging, and yet we're the most judgmental culture ever. You know, I'm a Planet Fitness member. You guys know what that is? For those who work out, okay, I go there about 9 times a year, okay? Don't judge, okay? In January, I go 2 or 3 times a year because what do we all do? Make a resolution in the last 2 or 3 days. And then around June, I have a midlife crisis during the whatever, and I work out 2 or 3 times around June or July, and at the very end I work out around December, because I've never not gained weight in December, so I work out 2 or 3 times. But if you ever go to Planet Fitness, $10 a month, okay, there's a no judgment zone. The whole place is you can't judge people no matter how out of shape they are. I love it, okay? But we are so judgmental. And aren't you glad that social media had absolutely no part in helping the polarization of our country? Aren't you so glad? Okay, we live in a call-out culture, and rightfully so that we call out sins of our culture. But how ironically, you know what the very name for church is in the Greek ecclesia? We're actually called the called out ones. We're called out to love, but to love in truth. I mean, to truth and love. If you really want a person to change, I don't know if you know this, but condemnation never works in changing behavior. It never works, okay? It's your kindness, O Lord, that leads to repentance. But this is not just a problem for the world, but honestly, especially for Christians, it's a problem within Christianity. But for a lot of non-Christians, right, this is the only passage they know. Do not judge. But this is one of the most misinterpreted, misapplied passages in all of Scripture, okay? But let's be honest. Christians in America, we're not that good in this area of judgment. In 2007, 16 to 29-year-olds, 87% of non-churchgoers say they see Christians as judgmental. 87. I'm surprised it's not higher. And 85% of non-churchgoers see Christians as being hypocritical. And these two words are in this passage. It's almost like God prophetically knew what was the biggest turnoffs for non-Christians and why they don't come to church. Okay? And they're absolutely right. They're absolutely right. We're extremely hypocritical. We're very judgmental. They're very right. And that's why they're welcome to this church as well. Because we're all hypocritical. We're all judgmental. But that's not God's call for his church. God refuses to engage in condemnation or judging. He welcomes, he accepts at great personal cost, right? And so the church should be the most least judgmental place on earth. Okay, we should be the least judgmental person on earth. Because if Christians are known for anything, okay, it should be this, that this place should be a radically inclusive, non-judgmental, grace offering, soul healing, fear melting, misfit embracing community of rational acceptance. You like that? Okay, we should be a place that is radically inclusive, non-judgmental, grace offering, soul healing, fear melting, misfit embracing community of irrational acceptance. That's what we should be. Okay, I would love for people to say this about Christians. Okay, you know I have dark secrets. I'm really afraid to tell even my therapist about my dark secrets. I'm afraid to tell the bartender at my bar. I'm afraid to tell my 12-step group community or my best friend. I'm afraid to even tell my dog because they might judge me. If you have a cat, they will definitely judge you, okay? But I can tell the church my dark secrets because I know the church is a place where no one ever judges, okay? How great would that be? How great would it be if you were on a bus or a plane? Do people ride buses anymore? Anyway, planes, right? Okay, and you see a guy that just outwardly, you kind of start, you know, they look like they might have some sort of issues, okay? And the first thing you tell them is, hey, I'm a Christian. And how great would it be if their response was, I'm so glad you're a Christian because I am so jacked up, messed up, junked up. I am messed up financially, emotionally, sexually, morally, relationally. And I thought I was going to sit by somebody who might judge me. But thank goodness you're a Christian, because I know you will not judge me. I'm going to tell you everything about my life because I know this is a safe place of grace. Okay? How great would that be? How great would that be? Okay? I find it so interesting. Like I said before, Jesus is the most holy man that ever walked on earth. And yet he was the least judgmental man that ever walked on earth. Maybe we should define what our thoughts of holiness should be. Okay? He's the most holy and the most least non-judgmental, okay? Because here, today's message is very simple. In the KJV, thou shalt not judge, okay? We need to get rid of this practice of blaming, condemning other people, and especially ourselves. For those who are biblical scholars, this is right in the middle of the greatest sermon that was ever preached, the Sermon on the Mount, okay? This is the most impactful talk in human history. And this actually leads to verse 7, the golden rule. You know the golden rule of living? Treat others as you want to be treated, okay? And so what Jesus is trying to do through this sermon, he's trying to describe what human life should be like, what human relationships should be like, how we as citizens of the kingdom of God should be radically different than this world, how we should live here on earth. And smack in the middle of this is chapter 7, do not judge. This is the pivot of the whole sermon, because what is the greatest commandment? To love God and love people. So what do I say all the time? What's the greatest sin? The refusal to obey the greatest commandment. Your greatest sin is not you getting drunk or doing this and that. Okay, the greatest sin is your refusal to obey the greatest commandment, which is to love people. Now, like I said, this is what Jesus is talking about in judgment. But this is not what this text is saying. Okay, remember what I said earlier? This passage is misinterpreted and misapplied. This does not mean that you never make any moral discernments. Okay, this doesn't mean that you don't ever be wise or correct people. For example, for those who go to the dentist, okay, and a dentist checks your teeth and say your dentist says to you, you know, your gums are receding, you have 3 or 4 cavities, it looks like that you might need a crown or a root canal. That's the dentist's job, okay? I should not say, don't judge me. What kind of dentist are you? You're judging me. You're a bad dentist. No, he's not condemning me as a person. He's telling me so I can keep my teeth because I like my teeth. But if a dentist would say to you, you big dummy, I've seen better looking teeth in a comb. Okay, your teeth are yellow, stained, dirty, crooked, disgusting. Your teeth is a big joke. Bugs Bunny have better teeth than you. I despise, I contemn your oral hygiene. No, you're low genes, okay? So what is your response to this? Well, first of all, you might want to change your dentist, right? But second of all, he is condemning you. He is judging you, okay? So in our families, in our relationship with people, in workplace, we must discern what's wrong, right and wrong. We must train ourselves to correct or train or respond, discuss the failure. Could you imagine having kids and you tell them, you know, I will never ever discipline you. I will never correct you. You know what we have? Some jacked up, junked up kids. That's what you're going to have. Okay? Listen, there's a way of correcting someone without forgetting their worth as and dignity as human beings. Okay? So when you judge people, you know, what you're doing is when you condemn people, you're crippling their souls, okay? You are not loving them and you damage them and corrode their personhood. So why would anybody do this? So that brings us to our first of 3 points today after a long introduction. Number one is why do we judge? Why do we judge? First of all, let's be honest, it's kind of fun. It's kind of fun. I mean, we do it recreationally, right? Some of you guys are part-time judgers. Okay, we judge us because it makes us feel superior, okay? And guess who's the most guilty of judging? Guess who's most guilty? It starts with a P, not physicians. Oh, I met some of them, they are judgmental, okay? Not plumbers, hopefully not because I do have a leak in my kitchen faucet, I'm not kidding. Phil, no, he's the least judgmental Phil Kim that I know in the church. That teaches Wash Jesuit, right? Pastors, we're the worst. We're the worst judges, okay? And you notice that religious people are sometimes most prone to be judgmental. And the more devout sometimes we are, the more judgmental we become. Don't judge me, okay? This is before, I still watch some of it here. You old timers, we have people from like 18 to 70, okay? There's a television show, I think it's still going on. I started watching this in college, okay? Like in 1989 or something. You ever heard of a show called Simpsons? You ever heard of Simpsons? And there's a character right next to Homer and Marge, Ned Flanders. And he was the next door neighbor. He was like this evangelical neighbor. And do you remember that episode where those old timers, where he's been away to a Christian camp. And then he tells Homer, you know, we went to a Christian camp where we were learning how to be more judgmental. Okay, I don't know if you've seen that episode. Okay, but it's not just Christians, it's everywhere. This world trains us to be judgmental. In our culture, we are encouraged to be arrogant, to have contempt, to have enjoyment for those who fall, right? Don't we say this when we hear news? Can you believe how dumb that politician is? That movie star, that CEO, that celebrity was? Of course, we would never do that. Of course. I love what Dallas Willard's definition of judgment is. It's the best definition I've ever heard. Speaking from a distance and secretly wanting that person to fail. I think that's a great, great definition of hypocrisy, okay? And so we're trained in this world. We have this judgmental spirit in our world that constantly wants to fight and fault in others. We actively seek it out. We savor it. We have that heart that wants to condemn people because we love to sit on that seat of righteousness, okay? And so it's interesting about this passage. He never stresses on the person who's sinning. He censors on the word you, not Reverend you or associate pastor, but you or Jay Young you, okay? But he focuses on you. He's not really concerned about this other party. I think he's trying to tell us something. Because when you judge, it has a lot more to do with you than it has to do with the person you're judging. Some of you are like, oh, Pastor Che, God, you don't know what I'm going through. You don't know the people I deal with. Yes, it does. He is God. It helps to know everything. He knows. You know why you judge? It's because deep inside, not to go into psychology or whatever, it's because you feel deep anxiety, inadequacies, and shame. And so you make all these strategies to make yourself look good. And so what you do is you try to avoid all those experiences and pain experiences, and that's precisely where judgment comes in. Because you don't know how to deal with these issues yourself, so you try to end up dealing with that through other people by comparing yourself to other people and by judging other people. And the reason why you're so prone to judge is because it's not about them, it's about you. The lower the sense of yourself, the higher the chance that you're going to judge other people. And that's why we find fault in other people so much when we're not doing well spiritually. I am much more critical, I'm much more judgmental when I'm not doing well spiritually. I know I'm not. I love what C.S. Lewis says. He says, pride in itself does not take pleasure in itself, but only having more of it as opposed to the next person, okay? People are not proud of being smart. They're proud of being smarter. People are not proud of being rich. They're just proud of being richer. People are not proud of being good looking. They're just more proud of being better lookinger, okay? Have you noticed that we love putting those letters ER at the end of positive adjectives about us, but ER and others at the end of negative adjectives about other people? Have you noticed that? We love doing that. We need others for our sense of worth, to uplift ourselves. That's what we judge. That is the root of why we judge. And so when someone else judges, when we judge other people for a small sawdust, a speck, when we have a log in our eye, okay, let's change it from a log to some of you guys from the Bay Area. Let's call it a sequoia. Some of you guys have sequoias, redwoods in your eye. Some of you guys have a telephone pole in your eye, okay? And what does Jesus call them? He calls them a hypocrite. A hypocrite is someone who maximizes the fault in other people, but at the same time, minimizing the fault in themselves. Don't judge me. I got this from Facebook, okay? A hypocrite is someone who maximizes the fault in other people, but at the same time, minimizing the fault in themselves. Because we don't want to spend time in introspection and reflection of ourselves. And so in this passage, he asks two questions. Why would you do this? How would you do this? Why? Jesus is exasperated. How is it morally feasible for you to have this log in your eye, this sequoia in your eye, and you judge people who have a speck in their eye? It's interesting, in the Greek, the word for look, about looking for other faults in other people, is the word blepo. And blepo means you casually just judge, you casually look. The word for looking at your own log is the word katanoe. It means deep reflection, deep contemplation. And so what Jesus is saying is, you notice other people's faults just casually, just naturally, but you don't katanoe, you don't reflect on your own issues, okay? In the Bible, are we ever told to reflect on other people's failings? Never. You're just supposed to notice them. But we are told absolutely over and over again to reflect on our issues. So stop meditating so much on other people's issues. Start meditating on your own issues. This is what gossip is all about, right? You're meditating on other people's news and issues, and you love it. But what does Scripture say? Search me, O God, if there's something wrong with me, if there's sin in me. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to you, O God. We are to katanoe our own sins. You read any sort of theologians, probably, I'm not sure if he said this, but theologians like, I don't know, N.T. Wright or anybody, they lament the fact that our culture, our century, we are more informed than any culture in history, but we are the least reflective, self-reflective of any generation ever. There's no longer contemplation of ourselves. There's no longer think of the high and lofty things. And so what does that do? It breeds a culture of narcissism. Not contemplation, narcissism, self-absorbed. We're no longer concerned with self-reflection. We're no longer interested in self-evaluation. And Jesus is like, I'm amazed you see other people's faults. You're not even aware of your own faults, okay? All right, sorry, don't judge me, okay? So Jesus is why? How can you do this? Jesus is like, he calls them hypocrites. In verse 5, don't you love Jesus' bluntness? You hypocrites. Aren't you glad I don't preach like Jesus? How would you like it if I started this sermon? You hypocrites. Okay, some of you guys might like it, okay? Because you have Korean parents. But anyway, all right, but you know, Jesus is like harsh with them. You know, Puritans get a bad rap, but they're actually you know, some of the diaries you read about them, they're actually happy, but Puritans, they had a number of things you cannot do. You know, one of the things they were not allowed to do is you cannot go to a theater, okay? You cannot go to the, not because they thought it was evil. Do you know why they forbid people going to the theater? Because the whole concept of acting, of being someone you're not, appeared to the Puritans as being beneath them, okay? And so that word hypocrite, you know where it comes from? It comes from hypocrites. It basically means behind a mask, speaking. It basically means an actor, okay? And what the Puritans felt like was you're building bad habits, watching people fake who they really were not. So they would never visit Hollywood, okay? Now, I actually disagree with them. I love movies. I love theaters. But you understand where they're coming from, okay? But have you noticed a lot of times? This is so true. If you really do self-contemplation, the thing that you can't stand about other people is the very thing you can't stand about yourself. Have you noticed that? Because it reminds you of someone, doesn't it? Someone you know very, very well. That's why you can spot it so easily in other people. That's why you're an expert in the area. That person is you. That's why it bothers you so much. C.S. Lewis says, do you know what? Who offends prideful people the most? Prideful people. Because they see it in themselves. I love what John Stott said, a good friend of N.T. Wright. He says, we love seeing our faults in others and judging them vicariously. In that way, we enjoy the pleasure of self-righteousness without the pain of penitence. Isn't that interesting? We love judging other people so we don't have to deal with it ourselves, because it's so painless to judge others, okay, as opposed to contemplating our own issues. You guys remember the story of King David in his later years? Remember? He was just kind of, he was not doing well spiritually. Okay, he was on his roof, saw a beautiful woman, Uriah's wife, Bathsheba, okay, slept with her, committed adultery, and had her husband get killed, Uriah. And do you remember, the prophet Nathan came to him and said, you know, one day, let me tell you a story. Let's call her Mary. And let's say Mary had a little lamb, okay? And his fleece was white as snow. Wherever Mary went, the lamb would go with her or something like that, right? And so let's say Mary had this little lamb, okay? That's not the story, it's a guy. Anyway, okay, he's telling this story, and there's this rich man who had thousands of sheep, but, you know, this little Mary had her lamb. It was like a sister to her, a brother to her. That's the only thing she had. That it was her, like, thing that she loved the most. And this rich man stole the sheep, took the sheep away from Mary. And you remember what King David said, his response? That man deserves to die. He deserves to die, okay? And we're just talking about sheep here. And Nathan's like, don't you understand? You're the man. You're a bad man. Okay, you're a bad man. Okay, don't you understand? And he's like, you're talking about sheep here. No offense. You're talking about speck here. You killed a man to get someone's wife. And here you have righteous indignation about this story about someone's sheep being stolen. Isn't that what sin does? It warps reality. It changes your view on things. And if David can do it, we can all do it. I love what one commentator says, that David is subconsciously passing judgment on someone else to evade his own guilty conscience. He responds harshly over a lamb because he himself has his conscience and guilt that is triggered. And so the thing that gets us most worked out about another person, do you know why it bothers you so much? Why you judge it so critically? Because a lot of times it triggers you in yourself something that is wrong with you, okay? And you're seeing a part of you that you know deserves judgment. But instead of dealing with yourself like King David did, you decree a harsher judgment on that person in order to appease your own guilt, right? That's what we do. It's easier, isn't it, to face who you really are? You notice that David doesn't go to God for this issue. He tries to do it himself. He tries to save himself. Listen, you know why God is so against judging? And this is the middle of the whole Sermon on the Mount? Because you're breaking God's great dream for humanity. What do I say all the time, Dallas Willard? God's great dream for humanity is to create an all-inclusive community of loving persons with himself as most glorious inhabitant. That's God's great dream for humanity, okay? He wants a loving community, heaven on earth, a great community. So do we have any hope, okay? So that brings us to the second point. How do we change? At this point, we're just a bunch of people with huge lumps of logs in our eyes. Can you imagine if that was literal? Can you imagine coming to church with logs in our eyes? It's just the blind leading the blind. Can you imagine? Just logs? Hello, I can't see you. I'm blind because I have this log in my eye. Okay? In verse 5, he says first. It's such an important word here. Okay? Because remember, he's telling us what kind of citizen he wants us to be. He wants us to see clearly ourselves where we can bless others. Isn't that the great Abrahamic covenant? God blesses us so that we can bless others. But what do Christians do? We just want blessing for ourselves. I say this all the time. KCPC would be judged not how well we do, how much we're blessed, but how much God blesses us through us to people outside these walls of 8220 Bressville Road. God wants all of us, okay, in elevating our great elder, Carl Shen. Okay, God wants all of us to be spiritual ophthalmologists. He wants us to be great spiritual ophthalmologists, okay? If we don't, we're not going to heal, bless others. We're just going to hurt people. So Jesus said, you need to be healthy first, okay? So how do we get out of this cycle breaking, judging people? First is get off the throne, okay? Get off the throne. That is a divine vocation. No one has that job description. No one. Only God has that job description, not you. So quit this job. Quit this job of judgment. You know, and back in the end of February, I went to Elder Case House, okay? And they told me my job description. They said my job description, remember? Preach, lead, guide, disciple. 4 years ago. They never told me that I had to sing the doxology. That's not part of my job description. They lied to me. Every Sunday, you know what I'm most afraid of? Not my sermon. I have the worst voice in all of Cleveland. Elder Jay told me that in so many words. They didn't tell me this was not, I didn't know until April 1st, April Fool's Day. That's the day I started, remember? That you were supposed to sing the doxology. They didn't tell me. That's not my job description, okay? You know why? One reason why I liked the pandemic, I didn't have to sing the doxology. I was just behind the screen in my dining room. Some of you guys would literally laugh at me when I sung the doxology. You're judging me, and I'm really hurt. No, I'm not, okay? I'm not, okay? Okay? So don't judge me. It's not part of my job description. Well, your job description is not, it's not judging people. No one is qualified to take this divine occupation. But that's the human condition, right? We try to be like God. Even though we don't like someone telling us what to do, we love telling someone what to do. Unfortunately, here's the thing. You can't stop being judgmental by trying not to be judgmental. And so what Jesus says, the true change, that the only way you can have true change is to replace this system of trying to save yourself and bow at the feet of the one who's the only one who could be your judge. You have to stop trying to redeem yourself and go along with his plan of redemption. And that comes to the saving love in Jesus Christ. He is the only one that can get that plank out of your eye. And so you can start seeing people. Do you know why we hate seeing ourselves? Do you know why we hate seeing sin in others? Because at the end of the day, you're terrified to see who you really are. We're not sure we can handle the truth of who we really are. That Jesus is the only one who could handle the truth of who we are. He is the only one who could deal with the breadth and depth of your sins. He's the only judge that came down from his throne and paid a penalty for your sins. He's the only one who can take your place. Because every time we judge, you're in a way, you're kind of shedding blood. He shed blood once for all for you to give you the life that you did not deserve. He got the death that you deserved. So when he sees you, he does not see judgment or wrath. He sees you as his sons and daughters of the Most High God. Because we know, according to James, mercy triumph over judgment. That at the foot of the cross, I don't care what you've done or who you are, all ground is level at the foot of the cross. That is the gospel. And when the gospel, to the degree that you really believe that, you're going to start seeing yourself and others, okay, of who they really are, sons and daughters of the Most High God. And that'll give you a renewed sense of who you are and others. And then you will no longer judge people. Christians should be the least judgmental, but we know that we are only saved by grace and grace alone, not by your own works. I love what Mother Teresa says. The more and more you have Jesus in your heart, the more you'll see Jesus in everybody you see. And you'll start judging people less. And you'll be less judgmental, because we know that we're only saved by his grace and his grace alone. My son, I love my son, but they learned it early. My son is 5 years old. He is a five-year-old Pharisee. My son, but he judges my daughter all the time. Whenever she does something bad, he tells on her. all the time, even though he himself does it, even worse. You see this Pharisee, this being Pharisaic spirit, by the way, don't tell him, okay? It rises in us. It's called sin. We think we're better than other people. But when you have the gospel in your heart, you realize you're not better than anyone. It's by his grace and grace alone you've been saved. So the last one, how do we practically and daily become less judgmental? Okay, how do we do that? How do we lay aside judgment, condemning, and blaming, and thinking that we're superior to other people? Okay? Because you can't do it on your own. Because God wants you to be an oasis of self-acceptance, acceptance of others, and no longer a place of condemnation. Okay? You have to ask God to replace the spirit of judgment with spirit-powered, reality-based, genuine acceptance. I love when verse 1 says, "For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, will be measured to you." He's basically observing a general law of life. It's called the boomerang effect, right? The law of boomerang, right? Reciprocal, okay? You tend to get back what you give out, right? If you give love, you tend to get love. If you give anger, you tend to get anger. If you give joy, you tend to get joy. If you give it, you tend to get back what you gave, right? And so Jesus says, with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. So you have to make a decision every day. Okay, do you give a gallon of encouragement to someone, or do you give a teaspoon? Okay, do you give a gallon of mercy to other people, or are you going to just give them a teaspoon? Okay, what about judgment? It says, well, in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. In others, if you judge others as you would have others judge you, right? Don't you want people to judge you in a merciful way? How would you like to be judged? I mean, mercy with a teaspoon of mercy or a gallon of mercy? Now, when you come to judge me, I prefer you judge me with a bucket of mercy, okay? Remember, there's a whole story behind every person. You know my story. I told you over and over again how much hurt I got at a Korean church. Never thought I would be. When you look at other people, they have their own stories. They have wounds, then they have scars. They have hurts. All kinds of stuff has happened to them. Do you give them mercy, okay? Or do you give them by the bucket of mercy? So don't judge people. You have no idea what they're going through. No idea what they've gone through. Because Jesus, with the measure you use, will be measured to you. And when you see that, you see way past their failures, way past their shame, way past their unloveliness. Okay? Because that's how God changes us. That's how God changes people through us. Remember when Peter denied Christ 3 times? And the first time Christ sees them in John 21? Okay? Remember he meets Jesus at the crucifixion? And I imagine Peter saying, oh my, can you just imagine? You just betrayed the God of the universe. And can you imagine how nervous you are? It's one thing to be, you know, do something bad in your company and your boss is about to fire you. He's the boss of all bosses, okay? He's the creator of the universe. And you betrayed him. Can you imagine? Okay? And Peter's probably thinking, oh, you're going to fire me, right? You're going to get rid of me. And what does Jesus say? Fire you, get rid of you. I just invested a crucifixion for you, okay? Because I'm in the resurrection business, not the passing judgment business. So go back to work, feed my sheep, okay? Can you imagine the relief and joy and the grace of Peter? Can you imagine his life being turned upside down? Because now that when Jesus said, thou shalt not judge, that changed him. Listen, I know it's hard. I know it's hard. We have some sandpaper people in our life, right, that loves us the wrong way. But you have to love, okay? There's somebody in your life that is unlovable. I know they're cranky, they're greedy, they're needy, they're mean, they're wrong, they backstabbed you, okay? They might seem unlovable. Aren't you the same way? Aren't you unlovable, okay? Aren't you never mean? Are you ever not mean, okay? Are you always nice? No. No, we're all unlovable. We all have a bad personality. And the more you don't condemn other people, the more peace you will have, the more God will heal you of your shame, okay? And more you experience a new level of grace and joy in your life. You're going to have more at peace. You're going to start worrying less, brooding less, and you're going to have deeper relational moments with people. And you're going to think about yourself less. That's incredible. And you begin to encourage more, and you'll be a blessing to the world, and God's going to provide you with incredible grace and mercy every morning, because now you are ministers of this ministry of no condemnation, because he says there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. I'm going to end with this. Listen, one of the voices that you need to stop hearing, though, not only not condemning other people, the last thing I want you to do is feeling guilty after this. That defeats the purpose. Don't listen to the voice of self-condemnation. That's the worst. The more and more you don't condemn others, the more and more you stop listening to the evil one that wants to condemn you. What do I say all the time? God never discourages you. Never. Ever. Sometimes he'll prick you or discipline you, but he will never, ever discourage you. Don't listen to that voice. Hey, don't listen. Refuse to listen to self-condemnation. But instead, God, sorry for my sin. By your power, I'm going to try little by little every day. I'm going to share a story. She was one of my sister's good friends. Actually, the last time I saw her as a child was 1981 when I was 12. And then I saw her again in 1997, 16 years later in L.A. when my sister got married. The reason I'm telling you this is, she's a good friend of my sister, but I think they kind of had a falling out or whatever. She grew up in the same church as I did in Fort Benning, Georgia, okay, a military base there, okay? And she was a teacher's pet, and she was a judge. She was a Pharisee to the core. No one liked her at the church. I was the pastor's kid, so I rebelled at church. I was a bad kid. And she would always judge me. You need to know that verse, okay? You need to know that you don't have many stars in that. You know when you're a little kid, you have those stars to all the times you memorize verses. And whenever she came in, I know, here comes the judge, here comes the judge. Judy came later, but no one liked her except for the teacher, except for the Sunday school teacher. I couldn't stand her, okay? I couldn't stand her. She's just always judging people. You need to love God more. However, when you're a 12-year-old kid, you don't know the psychological makeup of someone who's hurt. So how did I respond? Not graciously. I just like, forget you. I was mean to her as well. Don't judge me, And so, over the years, I found out from my sister, she had a crush on me. I didn't know that she had a crush on me, okay? She's, I guess when you're kids, you're mean to people you like. Okay, I'm glad that's what happened as husband and wives. But back then, I guess when you're kids, when you're mean to someone, you like them. Kind of a weird concept. But anyway, later I found out that she had a big crush on me. That's why she was so mean to me. Okay, that really makes me like her more. Okay, anyway. So later I found out that she really liked me. Anyway, she went to Yale, which is one of the top 400 schools in the nation. And so I ran to her in 1997. And by then, I met Christ in 1992. So it's 5 years later. And one of the, I saw her, she was one of the part of my sister's bridal party in LA. And one of the first things I say to her, hey, listen, I'm so sorry if I was a jerk to you. And I was fully expecting her to say the same thing to me, because she hurt me more. I think she hurt me a lot more. I said, okay, that's it. Okay. I'd love to tell you a great story, but this was not a great story. She's like, okay. It's kind of cold. Oh man, dang. Okay, and the interesting thing is she actually left the faith, even though she was judging everyone else. And then later, my sister told me, I didn't know that she was emotionally and physically abused by her dad. She went through a really hardship. Okay, it was a dad that never was never said, I love you, never complimented her, just pushed her. And she thought her God was the same way. She made God into her own image. And of course, you'll never live to that kind of God. I don't want to worship that kind of God. And so eventually, she lost her faith in college when she went to New Haven, Connecticut. Okay, she lost her faith. And, I was so immature. I was 12 years old, don't judge me, okay? But I'm like, now it makes sense. Now it makes sense. If I could talk to her again, so I'm so sorry that you went through this. I'm so sorry you saw God like this, as a judgmental, angry God. I wouldn't want to worship him either. And, I wish I could have done a better job of being his witness, instead of judging you as well. And so, This judgment destroys community. It destroys your soul. It's when Jesus says, I do not judge. It's not a passage of judgment, even though that sounds weird. It's a passage of love. Because he wants you to be joyful and loving. This is part one, by the way. I'm talking about another one. Verse 6 is kind of weird about a pig. Okay, we'll talk about that next week. So today, when someone asks you what the sermon was about, you'll tell them, right? Thou shalt not judge. But if someone asks you, was the sermon any good? You'll tell them, thou shalt not judge, right? Amen? I know we're all Presbyterians, and we're not supposed to do this, but don't judge me. Amen? Okay? I know we're not supposed to say it's Presbyterians. We're not Baptists. Can you say amen? Amen. Not to the sermon, but Let's help each other. Let's help each other. And then at the same time, this is going to create all kinds of issues. What's going to happen is after this, okay, I'm not going to be judgmental. And then people say, oh, you're judging. You know, okay? There has to be a way, and I'm going to talk about this next week. Dallas Willard says, how do we create a community of non-judgmental people? It's that we no longer cooperate with evil, but in a way that's full of grace. And I'll talk more about that next week. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for this beautiful time, this beautiful sermon, this beautiful passage. This beautiful passage. Thank you for this beautiful passage. A passage that at first looks very, very angry. It's actually full of love because you're trying to create a community of non-judgmental people. I pray our church will be so loving, so accepting, so full of encouragement and inspiration and not judgment and hatred and exclusion. We thank you and praise you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We can all stand up at this time.
Out of sadness, from wherever you've been, come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow, and heaven can heal. Earth has no sorrow, and heaven can't heal. Lay down your burden, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home, you're not too. Lay down your heart, lay down your heart, come as you are.
There's hope for the hopeless.
There's hope for the hopeless and all those who stray. Come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, a rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Sinner, be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are to So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are.
Let's pray. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And his light be upon you and grant you shalom. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you all. Have a great week. Thank you.